Introduction. Welcome. I'm delighted you've decided to invest your valuable time and energy into this guide about creating your own products. I know all too well, firsthand, if you put any of these techniques into practice, the rewards you'll reap will repay you the time you take to read this today, many times over. Creating your own products is the quickest way to become known, establish your expert status, build trust with your subscribers and readers, build your list, track conversions and hone your products to even greater value for your loyal subscribers, make money. And the best part? You get to keep all the profits yourself. No more niggly $4 commissions being an affiliate for someone else's ebook. Why don't more people bother to create their own products? The truth is, many do try, but so often, products get put on the back burner. People are distracted into chasing the latest hot offer, or trying to learn how to use their autoresponders, or keeping up with their blogging lessons. Often, however, product creation slides to the back burner because you've got stuck on something you don't quite know how to do, or your instincts scream that what's being produced doesn't resemble the highly focused offerings of favorite top marketers at all. So would-be product creators get discouraged, and your project fizzles and dies an ignominious death. If that sounds like you, you're reading the right ebook, because I'm going to teach you how to produce professional quality products faster than you've ever thought possible. And I'm going to do it simply and efficiently, so you only grasp the points you need, and don't clutter your mind up with disheartening and confusing details you really don't need to know. We've got one agenda, in this manual, creating your unique, quality product, one that will bring you recurring income, again and again. Let's get started, shall we? And just for a little fun, I've given each chapter a ranking of difficulty. Why faster is better? I thought it was all about quality, you frown. Why are we talking about churning products out like tomorrow's tabloid? And if you're still not quite sure what I'm getting at, after staring at the above diagram, it's all about new, and not so new, marketers tending to blow product research and creation up to astronomical proportions till it takes on a life of its own. When that happens, it stops income creation in its tracks, so people abandon the project. In short, product creation turns into a bogeyman. And it doesn't have to. In order to really succeed in internet marketing, it's vital that you reach the point established, experienced marketers are already at, where product creation is just another quick method to keep your sales funnel flow spiraling smoothly through its income-producing cycle. The reason this split in product creation attitude happens? New marketers often feel so overwhelmed by the thought of creating the actual product itself, they lose sight of the big picture. First, the research bogs you down as you become more and more confused by all the tangents you can get sucked into. Then once you finally allow yourself to get past the never-ending research and start creating the product itself, it quickly becomes a huge undertaking that snowballs into a monster. An experienced marketer, on the other hand, has learned, usually by trial and error, to focus his or her research. The actual product creation takes place very quickly, they've done it before, and they know what to do. Most of their energy goes into promoting their product to their list, the way to making solid sales and profits. The proportions I've used in my drawing are approximate, yet they do give you a decent idea of how it should really be. Actual research and product creation should total no more than roughly 30% of your entire campaign maximum, and that's what your product actually is, just part of a campaign. The rest of your time is best devoted to promoting, selling, and something else we'll talk about much later, repurposing. You don't want to take so long to create your product, you get left behind as the market changes. The advantages of quick product creation. There are other good reasons to burst this monstrously growing balloon and get it back down to size. Being able to efficiently and quickly produce products gives you a firm seat as an authority in your particular niche. Allows you to test your it on your niche for response and relevancy. Allows you to quickly build an entire line of products for that niche, leading to a complete sales funnel progression, from beginning to end. Allows you to quickly go on to something else, if niche reaction is lukewarm to your initial offering, without seeing months of hard work, and a lot of personal and perhaps financial investment, wasted. Of course, the more new offerings you present, the more income you will make. This in turn will attract high-quality affiliates, especially if you offer your affiliates lifetime commissions on prospects they bring in to join your list. it does grow easier. Practice also makes perfect. The shorter the cycle you give yourself for product creation and promotion, the easier it becomes to turn them out, until it's practically second nature. Just think about baking, for example. The first time you tried to make a pie crust from scratch probably took you 4 times as long as it does now, assuming you still have time to bake. Or learning to use your Palm Pre, at first you were all thumbs, literally, and no doubt spent some time cussing out the keyboard as you tried to send text messages and made lots of mistakes. Now, you could bash them out in your sleep. By learning my product creation shortcuts and ideas and giving yourself focused deadlines, you will naturally eliminate wasted time and frustration. You'll learn to focus only on what's essential. Far from making your products feel slapdash, this will ensure they end up as targeted, lean punch packers. Products like these are what splits the pros from the wannabes. Nothing smells newbie more than a cluttered, messy, unfocused report or ebook, ones that tell you way more than you ever wanted to know about a subject. And a few other subjects on the side. When was the last time you downloaded an ebook and were delighted with its clear, no-nonsense content? I'm sure I don't have to tell you, they're few and far between. And when you get one like that, you treat it like a treasure. You happily buy the next product that author offers. And there's no reason that author couldn't be you. Short reports are. That's right, short. If you have any ambition at all to write your own stuff from scratch, and you're not intimidated by the thought of writing, this is the ideal way to get started. But don't worry, I've got lots more tricks up my sleeve if this section is not for you. How long should a short report be? As little as 5 pages, padded on top of that with necessary extras like legal disclaimer pages, your e-cover, and your table of contents. And certainly no more than 15 pages. That's basically enough to cover one aspect of a niche subject, or provide a short overview. Treat your short report as a teaser that will have your readers eagerly looking for your bigger product. A good approach is to stick strictly to the what to do, while your bigger product will offer them the how to do it. But make sure that what is really something they need to know, and give it your own unique twist or added value information not usually found elsewhere. How much should you charge? That's entirely up to you. Many people will offer up a short report as a free taste of what their larger ebook or report can deliver. The idea is to make the taster want more. Others are actually more successful with charging a small amount, often as little as $1 and usually no more than $7. This particular approach works better, however, if you've already got a list. Another thing you can do is market your short report for a limited time on one of the forums you belong to as a special offer. Let your fellow forum members purchase it for $1, telling them that after a certain date, it's going up to $7, or $8, or $9. You're bound to get enough conversions to garner 2 crucial advantages that will give your career a boost. 1. Useful feedback, which can help you tweak your product and correct any errors before you release it to the general public. 2. Testimonials, which you can use as part of your sales letter when you market it to the world. A great place to join, if you haven't already, is the Warrior Forum. This is the place not only to make special offers in the WSO section, but also get focused feedback, advice, and really original PLR. Which brings us to our next section. 60 things you can do with PLR. Well, okay. I'll admit up front I'm not really going to show you 60 things, that would be a whole ebook in itself. Though actually, I bet you I could. My point is, private label rights, PLR, products can be your own personal hidden treasure chest, ready to be rated and used any way you like, at a moment's notice. PLR is highly versatile, if the last thing you should ever think of doing is using it as is. Besides, that's the shortest way to getting the Google boot. Now, I know you're disappointed at what seems like a lame idea for creating a truly valuable product, but hold on a sec. Let me tell you a secret that not many newer marketers understand. Most PLR feels generic and recycled because people just don't know what to do with PLR pieces. And the beauty of it is, this is not rocket science we're talking about, just a few simple techniques, which I'm going to show you right now, on the spot. You see, there's PLR, and there's PLR. There's stuff that is pure junk, and PLR whose quality is so high, it practically rewrites itself for you. You'll know you've got hold of a quality piece of PLR if it's hot knife through butter, easy and fun to rewrite. Besides, we're not going to change just a word or two, we're going to use it as an armature, so we can turn it into something completely new, fresh and unique. If you've never been to art college, you might be muttering, what on earth is an armature? Well, if you've ever seen a gorgeous sculpture, like Rodin's famous The Kiss, it didn't start out as a perfect piece of polished art. First, Rodin made a miniature. But before he even got to that stage, he constructed a crude skeleton of sticks and wire. Lovingly, he fleshed over it with clay. And when the clay dried, he cast it in bronze. When that turned out well, he corrected a few small design mistakes, and did it again to produce the life-sized statue we know today. No one looking at that statue today would ever connect it with the crude structure of twigs and clay he first put together. So it is with PLR. It's your ready-made armature or skeleton. If you have a good, well-designed skeleton, you'll end up with a solid, valuable product. Your assignment for today, go find yourself a package of quality PLR. Start with the WSO section of Warrior Forum. You don't even have to be a member, all you need to do is click on the link to the offer, which is usually in the poster's signature. In fact, if you Google your niche phrase along with PLR, e.g., create a blog PLR, you'll most likely be directed to the Warrior Forum special offer section anyway. The other thing you can count on, when you purchase PLR from WSO, these marketers mean business. No Warrior Forum member in his right mind is going to offer fellow professionals PLR that is token slapped together. Google your search phrase anyway, along with the word PLR, and check out different sites. You'll soon learn to differentiate between PLR that rocks your socks, and PLR that would be better off lining your kitty's litter box, if you were wasteful enough to print it out. And now the part you've been wishing I'd hurry up and get to, how to use it and create your product. Creating your custom PLR product. I'll read through the PLR guide, to see what ideas it sparks. Make notes as you go, just opening Notepad or whatever text editor you prefer is fine, for this purpose. The notes can be about sections you'd like to expand. Delete any sections or parts that don't fit into your vision, if you're already developing one. B. Add in new chapters to its table of contents. You will use this as your skeleton. You won't be writing from scratch. C. Do some solid research, on the net, at your local library, or by interviewing experts you discover. Make notes. D. You read through the first chapter or section again. Read through your research notes, and decide whether or not, and to what section, you want to add this new information. E. Change paragraphs around, change chapters around, it's just the structure for your new product. It's yours to mold and shape as you please. Two tips to make life easier while you're doing this. Oh, set your word processor so that all new material you type, or all the old material, is in a different color. That way, you won't run the risk of accidentally leaving large chunks of original content in, verbatim. It happened to me once, I blush to confess. Oh, go through it and rewrite your PLR in one go. Don't try to polish it right now, or you'll fall victim to the trap of endlessly tweaking till you've stripped all life and your own unique personality right out of it. Repeat this process, chapter by chapter, or section by section. If you're adding a completely new chapter, read through your research before writing from memory, with a few quick checks or two, if your research contained highly specific data. Everyone is different in what works for them, but I urge you, if you've never done it this way, do give it a real try. Write at least one PLR article, special report, or ebook this way. If the method gels with you, it's one of the most proven efficient methods of written product creation there is. In fact, most professional authors, copywriters and marketers write from an outline, fleshed out with original research, this way. The other major advantage this method gives you, there is no interruption in the flow, which I guarantee there will be, if you write without a skeleton, or go back to sections too many times to niggle and play. Rewrite your book from beginning to end, before worrying about editing. This little trick will make your report or ebook feel almost like a conversation, translated by your reader as high quality. It's all about connection, right? But if you're more the visual type, and written products really don't set you on fire, let me suggest another great use for good PLR. Turn your PLR into a video series. The way to do this, repeat relevant information, broken down, this time, into essential points, onto slides you create yourself, with spoken commentary. And by the way, you can use simple screen capture methods to make your slides, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. The other great beauty of videos? They usually sell for a higher price than written ebooks and reports. Especially if you create a series of lessons and break your videos down into shorter chunks. Recent studies have shown that people actually prefer shorter video clips, they have less and less patience and opportunity to dedicate large chunks of time to things like videos. My next brilliant PLR idea. Create a physical, hard copy book. This is not as harebrained as you might think. There are physical product fulfillment companies like Lulu.com or Kunaki who will print, publish, and even ship each book for you at a very reasonable cost, on demand. That means never having to order a huge numbers of copies, and no getting stuck with unsold merchandise you've paid for but can't recoup. Also, no storing and shipping to worry about, too. You can use a fulfillment company like Kunaki for your DVDs, too. To give you an idea, Kunaki advertises their price for physical DVD or CD creation at $1.75 per unit at time of writing. No contracts, no minimum orders, and even a UPC barcode included. And there's nothing like the status of being an offline, published author. You can even order a batch of your own books for yourself and use them for offline publicity, such as getting press releases in your local paper and setting up book signings. Best of all, you can sell your books on Amazon.com too. And don't forget to include links back to your web-only bonuses for customers, where you reward them by allowing them to sign up in order to download more goodies. So not only will you be making physical sales, you'll be building your targeted traffic, too. Now, if you're ready for more ideas, let's move on to number 3. The interview bonanza. You rarely hear of this method among the myriad of write a report material on the net, but the truth is, this is the quickest, easiest, and most lucrative method of coming up with an instant product you could ever wish for. Not only does it never take more than an hour to create, in fact, a lot of people prefer 20 minutes to half an hour, you'll end up with a high-value audio product you can sell for an equally high price. What's the catch, you say? Well, interviews work best if you interview an expert. But the good news is, getting one to agree to be interviewed isn't as hard to achieve as you might think. And if you learn a few tricks, you probably won't even have to pay them to appear on your interview. Just follow these simple steps. 1. Get everything ready to roll. There's a simple reason for putting this particular cart, setting up your interview equipment, before the horse, contacting someone to interview. The more of a true expert your subject is, the more likely he or she is to have an already full schedule. Setting everything up to go at the drop of a hat means you can squeeze them in on the spot, in the event they answer your interview request with, "Well, right now is all the time I have, tomorrow I'm off to Florida." And web radio hosts will tell you that happens more often than you might think. Besides, once your interview setup is complete and tested, it's ready for every interview and every opportunity. How do you record an interview over the phone? Your best bet is Skype, a free program you install on your computer. Skype allows you to contact people, by phone or by instant messaging, at one click of your mouse, as long as they are signed up with Skype too. Long-distance calls between two people are free, if both are signed up on Skype, but if your subject is not, you can purchase Skype credits and cover the cost yourself. How do you use Skype in an interview? You speak to your subject via Skype and your computer, using your headset and microphone. Open your Skype program and dial them at the prearranged time, if you've added them to your contacts, or visit their website and click on their Skype phone number. If you have the Skype Firefox extension on your Firefox browser, the Skype phone number instant link will be displayed to all people on Skype, even though the average site visitor won't see anything more than an ordinary text phone number. 1. Test your equipment first. For your headset and microphone, make sure you buy a chat-compatible unit with a USB connection, at least 100 MHz. Strength and adjustable microphone. You can find fairly inexpensive models at your local office supply or multimedia store, but be warned, if you're paying less than $40 for your headset, the quality you're looking for is probably not there. You can also order Skype-specific headphones via Skype. You'll also need recording software. The best one I've found is Total Recorder. There is a free trial you can sign up for, first, to make sure it's compatible with your computer. And at a mere $17.95 for the standard edition at time of writing, it's a no-brainer. I recommend the Pro Edition, currently priced at $35.95. Yes, it has a free trial too. Get Skype and Total Recorder completely set up first. Then have a friend or relative call you for a 3-minute trial run interview to make sure there are no glitches. You do not want to find out that your mic isn't working just as you're starting to interview your guest. Make sure all your settings are correct, and that you're not having problems with volume or accidentally making explosive breathing sounds into a wrongly positioned microphone. When you feel confident everything's as good as you can get it, and your headphone mic is set at the correct distance for you, test it again, then telephone your actual interview subject at the prearranged time. Do a test with your actual interview subject too. Editing your audio. Audacity is one last piece of open source, free software you will want to download. It's an audio editor and will help you edit out any glitches, mundane bits, or personal comments at the beginning or end of the interview. You can also download free public domain music excerpts to play at the beginning and end of your interview if you like that idea. Partners in Lime has a great variety of not only free music clips, but sound effects, too. You can also Google free public domain sound clips to find specialized ones suited to your interview theme. No matter whose music you use, however, check the licensing information. Even if it says public domain, and especially if it says royalty-free, you'll need to ensure you are allowed to use it for money-making purposes. Remember, royalty-free does not mean free, it just means you don't have to pay royalties every time your clip is aired. 2. Contact people you would like to interview. Your best bet is to contact no more than 3 possible subjects at a time. Before you choose a guest, put some serious thought into which experts will help you the most in providing your subscribers with valuable interview material they'll be eager to pay for. You can take one guest and break an hour-long interview into anywhere from 5 to 15-minute segments in order to create a paid e-course, or you can interview several guests in your narrow niche area to create a really high-value series. Where do you find experts? Book authors are often pleased to be interviewed, particularly if you allow them to promote their book. Look for authors with upcoming releases or those with a book just out. Amazon is a good place to look, and you can also see how popular their material is. Forums are another great place to uncover experts. Even if the world at large isn't aware of your guest's existence, forum members they've guested on or run are built in fans. You'll be able to see how eagerly the other forum members depend on them for advice and input. It stands to reason that an authority figure like this expert could be a valuable score for you. Check out top blogs and websites in your chosen niche subject too. One last place to dig, about.com. They pay expert guides to be responsible for each area and sub-niche. Pick the one you want and approach them. It really is as simple as that. Before you contact any potential guest, however, do take time to read their blogs, websites, and even books. Even experts are flattered when they realize you're an expert on their work. And it will not only help you better connect with your expert, but add depth and relevancy to your interview, as well as making you feel more confident. What do I pay them? There's no hard and fast rule for this. Often, if you've approached your expert properly and made a connection, they'll be willing to do the interview merely for the chance to promote their new book or product. Offline guests who don't have a website are not likely to be interested in web exposure, so you may have better luck asking them, "What is your usual fee for agreeing to an interview?" If you're lucky, the amount won't be sky-high out of the ballpark. If your expert is someone from a related area of your niche market, the best thing you could offer them might be 100% commission or resale rights to the final product, which would allow them to offer it as a special to their own list, and that's good for you too. If you follow this route, however, do make sure you put an affiliate link within the product. Their list members signing up for your list is the most valuable benefit you could reap if you're fairly new to internet marketing. And don't fret about the possibility of rejection. Yes, you'll have rejections, but most likely your personality will be the last factor in their refusal. The most common reason for refusing is tight or conflicting scheduling. All you need is one expert to agree to that first interview. And you'll quickly find out, once you've got one interview up and running, more will follow. You will have established your interview credibility, particularly if you've made your subject sound A. good, B. happy to be interviewed. 3. Have your questions ready. Choose the best of both worlds when conducting an interview. Oh, have your questions ready, they will provide your skeleton, your armature, for the interview. Oh, be prepared to go with the flow. If your subject is revealing some fascinating new insight into what makes them tick, details you know your niche would love, abandon a few of your more standard questions and encourage this detour. Remember, your questions are just a loose structure to fall back on in case your guest turns out to be unexpectedly wooden. Oh, make sure the majority of your questions focus on one topic of value to your niche segment. Oh, make sure you've included open-ended questions that invite more than a one-word answer. Example, where do you see yourself 10 years from now, is an open-ended question. Do you like Google, is closed, it invites a yes or no answer. And if that's all you get, the silence is going to hang heavier than a lead balloon if you're not ready to recover with a nice, fat, open-ended, what do you see as Google's biggest mistake this past year? Oh, do send your subject a.pdf of the basic questions he or she can expect to be asked. Most people will appreciate it and feel relaxed enough to provide a good interview without awkward pauses by the time you get around to the big night or day. Oh, don't be afraid to gently bring the interview back on topic if the subject has gone off on some tangent that is going to bore your niche segment to tears or disrupt the cohesion of your topic. 4. The actual interview. So you've arranged a time and done a test call with your subject to make sure your equipment is compatible from their end as well as yours. Start recording the moment you place the call. You can easily edit out any preliminary hellos or uncertainties. Besides, if you don't, you run the risk of forgetting to actually press the record button once you begin interviewing them. That would be heartbreaking, after all your hard work, as well as embarrassing. I know a really famous internet marketer who interviewed a fellow professional for an hour and completely forgot to record the interview. She passed it off to her subscribers as equipment failure without blinking an eyelash. However, she could get away with that, it was such a rare mistake, no one even questioned it. In fact, I would have taken it at face value myself, had she not fessed up to me, out of the blue. Don't be afraid to chat a little before you begin the actual interview. It helps establish a more natural connection between you both. When you're both comfortable, let them know you're about to proceed, confirm once again that they are fine with you turning it into a product. Above all, relax, enjoy the interview, and your guest and listeners will enjoy it too. But what if I'm really too nervous? I'm tempted to say get over it. You're an entrepreneur already. Entrepreneurs are supposed to be risk takers. But I won't. We all have our bugbears and phobias. Just make sure yours really is that, a genuine phobia, and not just a perfectly normal whack of natural stage fright, before you look for an alternative or give up on the audio interview idea altogether. If you are genuinely phobic, or there's some other reason you can't conduct the interview yourself, like you broke your jaw and your mouth is wired shut, you can hire someone else in your niche market, perhaps a local web radio host, or someone who specializes in audio interviews from Guru.com or Elance, to do it for you. A hidden advantage with this is that some of these professionals have superior audio equipment they will use. If you approach them, ask. 3 last words, however, before you go this route. Oh, be sure your guest knows you're using a stand-in interviewer. Oh, try to do it yourself. It's one of the best ways to let your target audience get to know you. There is an immediacy and intimacy to spoken interaction that all the best writing in the world cannot replace. Oh, have a glass of water handy, but not near any audio equipment. There's nothing worse than suddenly developing a dry throat or tickle in the middle of a good interview. 5. Editing your interview. Editing makes all the difference between a professional, polished interview and a home recording, so do using your Audacity software to edit the interview. Listen carefully to the recording after the interview. 2 or 3 times is best if you can handle that. I find I'll often notice things I need to edit on the third time round that I won't catch on the first run-through. B. Edit out long silences, awkward segues, introductory conversation, the bit where you double-check with your subject that it's okay to sell the interview, or outside noises. This is a simple, drag-and-delete process in Audacity. C. Keep a backup of the original tape. This is to guard against the unlikely event you ever have to prove anything. 6. Transcription, anyone? More people than you think are either on dial-up or just don't like multimedia interviews. Spending a few cents extra to provide a .pdf transcription to your subscribers gives an extra, and often much appreciated, source of added value. It also allows you to charge slightly more. Again, you can hire someone from Guru.com or Elance to transcribe it, or avail yourself of the services of one of the many virtual assistants on the net who specialize in transcription. You can also use Skype's Pamela service, or an actual transcription service such as CastingWords.com, but these two options will definitely be more expensive than hiring a VA or freelancer. Whoever does it, let them know you want it to stick pretty close to verbatim, but that you do want the and oh crap, I dropped my mic type comments deleted. Otherwise, you are likely to spend another hour or two you don't have manually deleting these yourself. When dealing with new service providers, as my own VA famously once said, when in doubt, spell it out. The last step, include a short .pdf file containing a brief summary of the audio file's content, as well as any links included in your chat. And there you go. One of the easiest products you'll ever create, once you've got the hang of Skype and Audacity. Moving on. Begin. Teleseminars are not so hard. After you've given a few telephone interviews, you'll probably find they're a complete yawn, apart from a few moments of nerves, right before you. Or you may even be like me, and discover that you absolutely and unexpectedly love the spoken word as your natural medium. If either of these is true, you'll probably be chomping at the bit to tackle teleseminars. I know when I was first starting out in internet marketing, I was too embarrassed to ask, what is a teleseminar, anyway? It's basically a telephone conference call, where your subscribers listen in, after being given a password. Sometimes all microphones except yours, and your special guests, if you have one, are automatically muted until someone activates theirs, hopefully at your invitation. Sometimes, if the teleseminar is 100% telephone-based, which many are, though recordings are usually made available later over the web, you need to tell everyone when you are muting the phones, and, once you unmute them for the Q&A, a session, how to unmute them. The best way to get everyone at ease, chat with your callers before the official recording begins, they'll be landing in the room early. Then let them know you are going to mute the phones for your interview, but there'll be a question and answer period afterwards, where they'll be able to mute and unmute at will. Don't give them the simple 3-digit code to do this till right before the Q&A, a session. Who do you interview? That depends. You might want to just give the teleseminar all by yourself, skipping the interview format, especially if you're good at storytelling or public speaking, or you have a unique skill few other marketers possess. Make your teleseminar 45 minutes to an hour of focused, high-value information on a subject they really want to learn, something you can speak about with authority. Or you can interview an expert special guest over the phone lines, while your callers listen in. When you unmute the lines for the Q&A, a session, sit back and allow yourself the luxury of listening to your special guest answering audience questions. Make sure you've both agreed on this, first. Plant a colleague or two in the audience, if it's your first teleseminar. Have them ready with an intelligent question or two, in case there's a deathly silence when you open the phone lines. But prompt them to wait for a certain number of seconds before jumping in. Unsolicited questions are always more valuable and entertaining than planted ones. What can you use a teleseminar for? Oh, pre-selling your audience on a membership site or other new product. By the time the call is ending, if you've done a professional, honest job and given them information of genuine value, they'll be loyal fans who totally trust what you say, and with good reason. Oh, make your offer exclusive. As registered members of this call, only you get this special pre-offer at a third of the cost it will be after its official launch. Oh, if you don't have anything yet to sell, or you're not comfortable with that idea, don't worry, you can please your callers and establish yourself as an expert by generously giving them really valuable information, totally free. You'll still make a profit when you turn it into your paid product. Teleseminars can be more powerful than a straight recorded interview for two reasons. One, you get real participation by your target group, who give you valuable, on-the-spot feedback about your subject. They may tell you what they need, what they're having problems with, or just tell you why your products or words work for them, and there's nothing stronger than a live, totally enthusiastic testimonial. 2. The personal connection you've made by speaking to them and allowing them input feels very one-on-one and builds trust quickly, particularly if you've encouraged them to introduce themselves and made a little small talk with your callers before the official recording got started. How do I actually set this up? Running a teleseminar is a little more technically challenging than recording a call with Skype. But don't get into a knot, it just means different software or software services. For a smaller teleseminar, which yours is most likely going to be, at the beginning, you might try freeconferencecall.com. Be aware, however, the reason it's free is because your callers pay for the call when they dial in. Especially good news for you, freeconferencecall.com records the entire event in .wav format, it's part of their service. You can easily convert your .wav files to .mp3. If you have a large list and over 100 people, you may wish to use a paid service like ncconnects.com. It doesn't matter which service you choose, however, both will give you a phone number you can give out and publicize as the number to dial in. Let those who sign up know. Oh, the time and your time zone, remind them they will need to convert the time if they're in another zone. Perhaps even give them a link to a free time zone converter page. Oh, any password or PIN code they will need to access your conference. Oh, remind them of your event at regular intervals before the call takes place, as well as sending a final email an absolute minimum of 1 hour before the call. Oh, remind people on your social networks. Keep tweeting about it on Twitter right till you begin the interview. I'm just starting my teleseminar on podcasting. You can still get in, http://www.mybit.ly link. Landing a special guest. Hooking a guest for a teleseminar may be more of a challenge than landing one for a pre-recorded audio interview. For one thing, your teleseminar is not going to be pre-recorded, it's going to be live, with a Q&A, a session. People most comfortable with guesting on live teleseminars will most likely be experienced top marketers. A possible drawback, they'll also expect compensation that may be more than you can afford at this stage. Their time truly is valuable. But don't give up on the idea. If you're ready to do a teleseminar, either be your own expert, or just keep asking around till you find someone who is willing to work with you, especially if you allow them resale rights or a full 100% commission on the proceeds. Getting people to sign up. It's better to choose the teleseminar option rather than a straight, pre-recorded interview. If you already have an established list, you're much more likely to have takers eager to hear what you have to say. But don't forget, even if only 5 people sign up, the people who buy your recording won't know that. I can guarantee they will literally be picturing a lecture hall packed with people as they listen, and even if there are only 1 or 2 questions afterwards, they'll either assume people were as shy as they were, or they'll think you covered the subject so well, there really weren't too many questions to ask. If you do have a smaller list, you can easily drive people to your teleseminar landing page through your normal channels, your blog, social networking, word of mouth on forums, and don't forget Twitter. If traffic is really going to be a problem, consider investing for a short time in a pay-per-click ad or placing a banner ad on a hot site your target niche members actively frequent. You can send the people who do sign up all the juicy details via email using your autoresponder. If you use a paid teleseminar service, they will also likely have their own version of sign-up and contact methods for you to use. The only real downside to hosting a teleseminar with only a small audience, you may find yourself paying for more service than you needed, after all. But then again, you'll have your paid product at the end of it, to help you recoup your finances. And do send regular reminders, they're the most crucial part of getting the people who signed up to actually attend. And you're live. As with your pre-recorded telephone interview, do test your teleseminar service first. You don't want to be hitting the wrong button or discovering you don't know how something works when you're live on the air. You also don't want to embarrass your special guest by appearing unprepared and unprofessional. That could backfire on your reputation quite nastily. But don't panic, instead, rely on thorough preparation and pre-testing. Remember the dummy run with a couple of friends or relatives. Make sure you run your 10-minute mini-session just like the real thing, muting the lines, opening them up again, allowing your guest access in the correct manner. Not every service does this the same way. With some teleseminar services, there's an actual co-host number your special guest uses. With others, you simply unmute your special guest when she enters the room. Teleseminar tips. Oh, have water available in case your throat gets dry. Oh, if you're your own guest, don't read verbatim from a script, it will sound lifeless and dull. By all means, use an outline or flashcards hitting the high points you're going to cover, so you can use them as cues, but imagine yourself speaking directly to just one person, perhaps that nice lady who was so cheery when she gave her name and greeting on entering the room. Oh, treat your callers as if they are paying good money for the call, even if it's totally free. Remember, they took time off other important tasks just to check out what you have to say. Honor this by imparting clear, relevant information they can really use. Oh, remember to tell people at the beginning of your call when and how long the phone lines will be muted, and when you'll be opening them up. Do not tell people how to unmute the phone until it's time. You don't want your show sabotaged by that one egotist who thinks he should harangue or question you or your guest mid-interview, interrupting the flow. Oh, do remember you can edit your teleseminar recording, just as you can a pre-recorded interview. This means if you get a questioner who is long-winded or irrelevant, you can choose to eliminate that portion if you feel it really weakens the interview or embarrasses your guest. If your guest is squirming, chances are your callers will be too, so you'll be doing them a favor by removing it. Oh, be prepared for people asking questions that are really not appropriate, things like, can you walk me through all the steps to setting up a WordPress blog in the middle of a call exclusively about copywriting? Or asking questions that have already been answered. You can take the sting out of shutting them down by prefacing your reply with a positive comment, "That's a good question, Ed, but we don't have time to cover that in our copywriting teleseminar today. Perhaps we can cover it in a future WordPress seminar. Thank you for that idea. Anyone else have a copywriting question I can answer?" Above all, be gracious. If you treat each caller as a valuable guest, which indeed, each one is, chances are, everyone will enjoy the call as much as you will. And your enthusiasm, and theirs, will show up on your paid product. But perhaps you are more comfortable with visuals. If so, let's look at our next method of creating your product. How to create a video. People who are comfortable with pre-recorded interviews will often freeze up and balk at the idea of doing a video, when the truth is, videos are usually even easier and quicker to create than audio. There is a visual, as well as audio, component to this type of product, so videos are traditionally seen as higher value than audio files, which means you can charge more money. Especially if you break them down, as suggested earlier, into segments and market them as a series. If you are really uncomfortable with appearing on video, consider screen capture videos. What are they? Well, if you've ever gone through a video series on how to do anything, and you're seeing it happen as if you're doing it on your own computer screen, you've been watching screen captures. Before you go running to learn about screen captures, however, try taking some very short videos of yourself, doing nothing at all, talking about what you're making for dinner, explaining why you hate potted plants or love pierogies, on your digital camera. View them. If you're like most people, you'll cringe when you first play them back. You won't have realized those wrinkles move and magically grow deeper. Your voice will sound tinny and thin. You'll think you have goofy teeth, or you'll hate the way the camera angle makes your nose look like an overripe banana. All these are normal reactions when viewing yourself for the first time. We have a mental image of ourselves based on the still poses we see in the mirror and what we look like at a younger age. The reality of how we really appear when we're animated can be an unexpected jolt. But get over it already. Carry your camera around. Make your 30-second video clips of yourself at your most mundane and boring. View them on the spot, right there on the camera. Delete each one, with a sigh of relief, as soon as you've finished viewing it. And you can do all this in private, when no one's around. I'll tell you what will happen, unless you're morbidly insecure for some reason, sooner than you'd have thought, you'll view one of these silly little video clips, and you won't feel like deleting it at all. In fact, you may even find yourself quite liking it. Congratulations! You've made friends with yourself at last. Susie, meet Susie. Craig, meet Craig. The truth is, your friends enjoy your company, and they don't care if you're not Hollywood thin or 19 years old. And they know perfectly well about your bald spot, or that mole on your upper lip. People are looking for solid market knowledge and tips they can use. Methods they can learn. Things that will help them make money, as well as making their life easier. That's what they're watching you for, not so they can condemn the shape of your nose. Why are you insisting I get comfortable with the camera, when I'm planning just to use screenshots? It's that personal connection thing again, of course. The truth is, while you're busy worrying about appearing on video, your viewers may have taken a mild dislike to you already just from your still photo, based on silly superficial details like your hairstyle, your weight, an expression they're perceiving as arrogant and supercilious. Gee, you thought it was authoritative and calm. Or perhaps they think you look like an oily used car salesman, as one friend once told me, when looking at what I thought was the best photo ever taken of me grinning at the camera. You mean I don't look natural and relaxed? Video is able to set the record straight. I'll go one further, no matter what actual physical deformity you could possibly have, the only one likely to be concerned about it, after the first few adjustment seconds, is you. The true secret of video is, if you can get to the point where you're comfortable with being on screen, everyone else will be comfortable too. Marketers have mentioned, again and again, how much better their screen capture videos convert, if they appear live and in person at least at the beginning and end of the video. So if you're able to push yourself out of your envelope of safety a little, the rewards of appearing on video can be well worth your initial reservations. What if I really can't appear? Well, no point making you do something you're genuinely, pathologically uncomfortable with. In that case, screenshots only, it must be. And as with the audio transcript, you can hire someone to make the video for you. Be aware, however, that this option is usually expensive. And your surrogate won't put the passion and enthusiasm into it that you will. What equipment do I need? Good question. For a free option, consider Cam Studio. Its drawbacks? Larger files to upload, which may put some viewers off, especially if they're on dial-up. It also offers less editing options. It's not a bad program to start off with, however. Paid screenshot capture software such as Camtasia, the industry standard, can be a real bite to swallow for new marketers, at $300 and up. However, you can sometimes find older versions advertised on eBay for considerably less. There's also a 30-day trial, so if you're really strapped for cash, wait until you're ready to shoot before you download the trial. You should be able to make your entire video series before the trial runs out. Then you will be able to purchase Camtasia with your profits. You can use your Skype headset, at a pinch, for a microphone. Another option, if you need to record live physical actions, for example, you want to create a video of you showing people how to turn a French seam on a Janome sewing machine, Camtasia won't do the job at all. A simple flip camera will do a decent job of video recording, and at about $160, it can be a viable option for newer marketers. If you can afford a little more, the buzz is that Kodak is about to launch the Hi8 HD. The big advantage here is its external microphone socket, something your simple flip phone lacks. It also will have a USB attachment, so you can download your video right onto your computer. Webcams, you say? Yes, that will work, but only if you want to do the talking head thing, and have it capturing you sitting at your computer. What subjects can I make videos about? The answer? Anything you think your niche market will value. It's true, however, that some things lend themselves better to a video format. Oh, web design tutorials. Oh, blog setup tutorials. Oh, software tutorials. Oh, how to, anything you like. In other words, tutorials top the list. Video record anything that's better explained by showing rather than telling. You can also use slides, still photographs, drawn diagrams, pie charts, PowerPoint presentations, etc., to help reinforce what you're talking about on your video. You can point to areas of the screen you're working with, rather than saying, now put slot A into the little groove about 2/3 down the left side of your screen, over a bit towards the middle. Best of all, people can refer to your video again and again, until they've really got the hang of how to do what they need to do. The nitty-gritty, please? First, decide whether you're going to produce a series, or one longer, complete video. Keep your invisible dial-up members in mind, before blithely deciding to make that 199 MB a video. If you're doing a series, decide which single topic each video is going to cover. But remember, even though each leads to the next, each should also feel complete. Write a skeleton outline for each video, just as you would if you were writing a special report. It will look something like this. Oh, welcome from me. Oh, brief description of what this module will cover. Oh, any fact my viewer needs to know before I get down to the instruction part. Oh, showing my viewer how to perform one section or task. Oh, telling my viewer that module has concluded, and what he's going to find in the next one.
Oh, remember to close mouth and freeze for the camera at the end.
Repeat this for every video module, and please, for heaven's sakes, even if you were initially forced to save your video with a file name like S44-1394S344BHXQWERTY91X.WMV, do rename it to something instantly recognizable and descriptive that will instantly tell your viewer which module he's looking at. For example, BlogSetupPlugins.WMV. When your viewer goes back to relearn that one particular point he's had trouble with, and discovers he can instantly put his hand on the right video file, without having to go through all 10 of your modules, he's going to be very pleased indeed. In fact, he's going to remember that. How many hundreds of .pdfs and video files do you have on your hard drive with file names like S44-1394S344BHXQWERTY91X.WMV? That's a surefire way to make sure your viewer will never find them again, even if he wants to. If you're having trouble visualizing your future video, access some of your favorite videos, ones created by others, and play them. Make notes. There's nothing wrong with copying general structure when you're first starting video production. Get your tripod, if you're using one, highly recommended, set up your camera or have your cameraman ready to go, and start shooting. Whatever you use, however, make sure it records sound too. Some tips. Oh, do remember to run a sound check first. Record a 20-second clip to make sure your sound is acceptable and actually working. Oh, have your notes in order, out of sight of the camera, but where you can glance at them. That way, if you freeze up, you can cue yourself and just keep talking. But do try not to refer to your notes unless you absolutely have to, it can make your video seem stilted and mundane. Creating screenshots and slides. You'll most likely simply edit your video in Windows Movie Maker, the free program that came with your PC. It actually works very well for video editing, you're able to drag and drop slides, alter the start point of video tracks, add effects, and slow or speed up each slide. Save your work often, Movie Maker can be glitchy at times. But how do you actually create slides? First, decide what job these slides have to do. If you really need screenshots, use your Camtasia. But what if you just want to get a point across or show a diagram? You can use a still photo, make sure you own the rights or have licensed the shot correctly. For example, if you were talking about meditation, you could show peaceful shots from nature, with soothing background music added in. You can create pie charts and show them as you're talking. Create your screenshots afterwards as well, if you see a spot on your edited tape a new diagram would enhance. Don't write an essay, if you're including writing on your slides, just the most crucial points for that one small segment, no more than 3 points is a good rule. You want people to scan and cue as you're talking, not struggle to read paragraphs, losing track of your voice. If you are giving out URLs, do display your URLs in a screenshot at the same time as you are speaking the address. This is far easier for your viewers than having them wonder, did he say Digimons or Digimoms? If you have your own logo, brand your videos with it. Have a tiny version of the logo inserted in the same spot on every slide, as well as your URL at the bottom. You never know when people are going to give your videos out to others, or claim your videos as their own work, especially if you personally don't appear in them. The mechanics of recording your video are much the same as doing an audio interview. The same interview rules apply, water glass and all. You can choose to edit out mistakes later, but another trick is recording in small chunks, particularly if you're just recording yourself and you feel nervous. I find small chunks are easier to edit than one large video, but it's all about whatever works for you the best. Do make a couple of test videos first and see which style you prefer. And remember, you can always just pause the recording. Tips unique to video. Oh, if you yourself are planning to appear in your video, begin and end the shoot by being quiet for a few seconds with your mouth closed and a calm, pleasant expression on your face, otherwise you run the risk of forever seeing your web page embedded video frozen with your face caught in what will inevitably turn out to be a goofy expression. And if you are talking too quickly, without pausing, it will be harder to edit these moments in a manner that comes off as natural after the fact.
Oh, even if you edit your file immediately after finishing, do put it aside and come back to it the next day for another edit. Chances are huge you'll find other flaws or mistakes you want to remove. Oh, don't reshoot and reshoot in an effort to attain perfection. The more natural you are, the more people will trust you, they'll identify with you. Being too slick can come off as artificial and insincere. As with your short report or PLR, do it in one go, from beginning to end. Oh, do make at least 3 versions, if that's possible. Sometimes the first one will work best, and sometimes the second or third really benefits from the run-through. And knowing you're going to do another couple of shoots can really help you relax the first time. Adding in sound clips is easy. In Windows Movie Maker, you just drag and drop. Once inserted, you can slide the clip to the exact frame, visual point, you want your sound clip to start. You can apply effects such as fade in or fade out. You can use only part of the sound clip. There's a great deal of leeway this basic program allows you. Once you're done, you can embed your video, or just the first one in a series, on your blog, for people to watch for free, or you can upload your videos to your shopping cart or site in a .zip file, and sell them as products. You can make them part of a membership site, and give people access once a month, or once a week, whatever time frame you've determined works best for you. And people have gotten to know the real you. But let's not stop there, with our product creation suggestions. There's another technique not many people take advantage of, at all. List and research sales. Selling lists or research packed full of targeted information can really add a unique twist to your business. It always surprises me that more people don't take advantage of this handy method of product sales. The fact is, your average new marketer's idea of research is looking something up on Wikipedia, which a professional offline journalist wouldn't be caught dead doing. If you've ever done this, it probably hasn't taken you long to realize you need more depth and better validated sources. You can give people a taste of your list value by offering a small freebie list, such as 21 powerful WordPress plugins. Larger lists packed with meaty research or valuable resource links are actually not that hard to generate, and you can offer your subscribers the true gift busy internet marketers are always looking for, a way to save time. If you are able to generate hot links or provide truly unique research, don't be afraid to offer these for sale also, or provide them as an incentive to join your paid membership site. Don't forget to test the waters in places like the special offers section of your favorite forum. Just make sure you target that list or research package to your niche market, or to another market that can really use them. When is a list long enough to sell? When you've got over 100 links, that's when to seriously consider compiling it into a saleable form and adding it to your marketing product's arsenal. You can add exclusivity to your list by offering it only to the first 200 people, or whatever number seems to work best for you. Don't just confine your list and research products to your own subscribers. Market research is a hot commodity for all aspects of business, garnering staggering price tags. Just take a look at PCA Bookstore to see for yourself. Research packages go for more than $500. What type of research packages can you offer? Here are just a few suggestions. Oh, survey statistics. If you have a larger list, you can generate these yourself by getting your members to participate in original surveys. Oh, products with particularly lucrative affiliate programs and the best payouts. Oh, lists of forums for specific, targeted traffic. Oh, in-depth niche research, authors, products, must-have links, statistics. Oh, what's hot for specific niches. Oh, top blogs in specific niches. Oh, top articles in specific niches. This is a great one to offer as a freebie lead capture offer. Oh, focused article directories. Oh, places to get valuable freebies, blog themes, scripts, avatars. Oh, places to find free graphics and graphics software. Oh, lists of specialty providers, e.g., drop shippers and wholesalers. Finally, create a survey of your own, survey your list and fellow forum members to find out what research they need. Then go out and provide it. The hidden advantages of resale rights. Everyone sort of knows what resale rights are. And many people ignore them, thinking them to be just another form of PLR. If this describes you, you're missing one of the easiest ways to create a unique product. What exactly are resale rights? Let's get that out of the way, once and for all. There are two kinds of resale rights internet marketers commonly deal with: resale rights, RR, and master resale rights, MRR. With resale rights, you have the right to sell the item you've purchased to others and keep 100% of the profits. With master resale rights, the above is also true, however, in addition, you in turn sell the resale rights to the product, along with the product. Which brings us to another important point: when considering dealing in resale rights of any kinds, always check the exact permissions granted in the license. Not all rights are given. The major difference between a resale rights product and PLR: you don't receive access to the original source files with resale rights. In fact, you're absolutely not supposed to customize the book in any way whatsoever. The key to success in offering resale rights: always offer only the best. It is better to offer 10 top quality ebooks than have a list of 3,000 for sale. In fact, if you do have a list of 3,000 for sale, especially if they're for very low prices, you run the risk of branding yourself as a bargain basement clearinghouse. You'll be the dollar store of booksellers. The best tactic to take is to build a portfolio of top quality book offerings. Your own product with master resale rights. And then again, you can always offer your own ebook with resale rights or master resale rights. There are two valid reasons for considering this. Boosting your profit at launch time: offer resale rights for a limited time only, or for the first 50 customers. Promoting your site or services: the links in your resale ebooks can bring in many new subscribers. How do I find quality ebooks to resell? One big clue: the best ones are usually only sold in limited quantities. Good old Warrior Forum Special Offers is a great, and often unique, source. But basically, any site that doesn't flood you with a list of 5,000 resale rights books, all at rock-bottom prices, is liable to offer better quality. Your best bet? Buy one and check it out. Two things to do if you find a great MRR offer, but the offer is closed. If you find a great MRR offer, but it's sold out or closed, enter the book title, in quotes, into Google's search box. You may find someone else who has purchased master resale rights who is still selling it. Also, make sure you sign up to the list of the original creator. You'll be first in line for his or her next highly relevant product. Must-do tips. Let me stress again: don't purchase any book with master or resale rights until you have thoroughly checked out the licensing restrictions. For instance, you may be planning to sell the book on eBay, only to discover that the author specifically prohibits this in the license. And do respect the suggested retail price of the ebook. Slashing the value may not only brand your product as bargain basement or make people think it's outdated, but you will bring down the value of the book for the people you sell it to. Not a good idea if you want them to treat the book as a valuable must-have acquisition. Can I really sell resale rights books on eBay? If the license allows, this is yet another avenue of marketing for you. However, do remember to check eBay's own rules and regulations for any changes in their guidelines. As of this writing, my information states you can sell resale rights books as long as you have converted them to a physical product, that is, they are on a CD or DVD to send your customers. Use a service like Kanaki to fulfill this. To brand or not to brand. One important point to consider: when purchase a resale rights book to resell yourself, or giving your own product some form of resale rights, whether or not to allow people to brand the book with their own site logo and name. There are pros and cons to both sides. Not allowing purchasers to rebrand your product is good, inasmuch as it stops them from editing it and possibly destroying the value and your links. On the other hand, its potential appeal and value is lessened because it is exactly the same book as everyone else receives. The promotional value for those hoping to sell it is decidedly lower. If you purchase resale rights packages that come with a landing page or sales letter, do carefully check the licensing to see what edits you are, or aren't, allowed to make to the sales pages too. Hidden gems. Occasionally you'll come across a hidden gem, a truly excellent book ripe with quality material, that no one has yet discovered, because it's suffering badly from poorly written sales pages. If you find one of these, snap it up. You can transform its sales potential with the addition of appropriate sales page graphics, professional copy, and better promotion. But again, check the license. If the license states that you can't alter the sales page, you're out of luck. Of course, you can always just ask the product creator if you can design a new mini site or rewrite the sales letter. If you position it positively, i.e., don't say your sales copy stinks, bozo, you may find the creator very open to some assistance in boosting its value. If you're able to play with the sales pages and mini-site, it will also strongly brand you with that product as its authority site. People will prefer downloading it from you, rather than from all the people slogging along with the poor quality, hardly readable sales sites. Also ask if you can customize or add sales page graphics. That's all you need to know, in order to decide whether or not you'd like to explore resale rights products further. But we're not quite finished with product ideas yet. Your secret weapon, repurposing. You wrote that ebook 2 years ago, but you were new to marketing and you didn't have a list. You made 14 sales, which totally thrilled you at the time, but now a good chunk of the information is outdated already, and it's deader than yesterday's tuna sandwich. Besides which, you can see now that a few sections were redundant and it needed a better edit. So what do? Consign it to oblivion? Chalk it up as a learning experience? Absolutely not. The truth is, it's probably a goldmine you can delve in and repurpose. You've already done the hard work. Why create something from scratch when you've got all the bricks and mortar sitting right there in your wheelbarrow? Yes, you also can repurpose PLR, but not our ARCFA products. Why can't you do it with our products? Well, you're going to have to rename the item you're repurposing, as well as give the content a makeover. That's not allowed with resale rights. The traditional way to repurpose involves: oh, turning your old ebooks into blog posts. Oh, turning your old blog posts into new articles or a new ebook. Oh, turning your old ebooks and blog posts into videos or audio files. You can see already, the possibilities are huge once you get yourself into the repurposing mind frame. Let's take an example. You created an ebook on how to set up your WordPress blog. Unfortunately, you didn't realize that three other How to Set Up Your WordPress Blog books were being released at the same time by marketers far more experienced than you, some of whom paid for top-quality professional writers. Your poor little ebook, written with such sincerity and in such a helpful spirit, didn't stand a chance. But recently, after attending a local offline networking business breakfast, you realized how many local businesses in your area were still struggling with huge web design fees, abysmal web design service, and on top of that, they don't have a clue about how SEO or web presence really works. So you repurpose your straightforward little guide into a new ebook called Never Pay a Web Designer Again: Small Business Web Solutions You Can Really Do Yourself. You market it to small business owners and small business networking organizations. You create a mini-site for it and provide a free sample chapter or two, just enough to light up your prospective customers. In your sample chapters, you show them how easy it is to create a great business website without knowing a word of HTML, after introducing them to the dazzling concept of search engine optimization, and how not to spend any time on it at all, by allowing their new WordPress blogs to do all the SEO work for them. You show them how many middlemen they can cut out, such as their SEO consultant. Oh, marketing consultant. Oh, web designer. Oh, graphics designer. And since you wrote the guide for absolute newbies, the sample chapters look pretty appealing to business people who haven't a clue how to do more than buy their office supplies online. Since offline business people often set greater store by physical products than do internet marketers, it's all about perceived value. Consider getting an order fulfillment company like CreateSpace.com, Kunaki, or Lulu.com to create a set of DVDs you can physically mail them. Another reason business people like DVDs, they can just hand off the set to a staff member and have that staff member become the resident expert on WordPress or whatever system you're selling. You can repurpose any product if you can find a new market for it. In fact, you can create different versions of the same product for specific and highly different niche groups. Oh, how to create the perfect law firm blog. Oh, how to create the perfect bookkeeper's blog. Oh, how to create the perfect virtual assistant's blog. And so on. The other great thing about a series like that, it really solidifies your image as the all-round expert on the subject you're selling. But what is the one common denominator all these products will need? You guessed it, a strong sales letter. Sales letters that sell. There's a saying among older marketers that a product is only as good as its sales letter. This is absolutely 100% true. You can sell a crappy product with a great sales letter, but you can't sell a great product with a crappy sales letter. However, there's a quick and easy way to stop yourself from turning your sales letter creation into the next immovable 60-foot wall between you and success. You know, that wall that stops all progress between you and your launch? There are plenty of basic copywriting courses, articles, and ebooks on the net to help you write your sales letter yourself. Look for ones that provide you with templates. In fact, you might want to start out with the free copywriting ebook offered here at PLR Canada. But if doing it yourself doesn't turn your crank, consider hiring a copywriter. If you think of the copywriter as the engine who is going to push your product over the finish line and into the biggest winner's circle, you can see why this may be the best bit of outsourcing you could choose to invest in. How good a job your copywriter will do depends, however, on whether you pick a quality copywriter. There are many copywriters out there, good, bad, and better. And not all of them charge the same price. You can hire a copywriter for peanuts, or you can hire one whose sales letter prices are up in the thousands. These latter copywriters are the sort who jump through hoops to help their clients' pages convert. They will set aside weeks on your project, tweaking and testing right alongside you, but be warned, they'll expect top professionalism from you too. That means sophisticated tracking systems, professional design teams, etc., etc. Let's face it, that's not where you're at right now, if you're reading this book. Hiring one of the $10,000 a letter guys is about as far from reality as stepping on the moon for you. But if you hire a cheap copywriter, are you throwing your money away? Not always. Very often, a copywriter charges humbler rates because he or she is just starting out in the business and is not well known yet. As one well-heeled copywriter recently commented to me, the difference between a $10,000 copywriter and a $10 one, nobody knows the 10-buck guy. But there is also a great deal of truth in the old saying, you get what you pay for. One way, find a good copywriter, decide on your budget, and I'll warn you, if you expect a quality sales letter for anything close to $10, you might as well sit down and start writing yourself. Then head on over to guru.com and Elance to post your job. Give your deadline and as many details, without revealing sensitive product information, as you can. Browse through other copywriting job proposals to get a feel for how the most effective ones are worded. Then sit back and wait for the offers. I guarantee that the first rush will be from people who can barely spell. You'll get letters like, "Dear Mr. Belinda Smith, I am wanting to write your letter of sale. I am experiencing copywriter." These ones hit the garbage can, metaphorically speaking, before you've even finished reading. The spelling and grammar were the big, flashing giveaways, right? But on the other hand, you may find an absolute treasure. It might be a completely new copywriter, or one from a country where $40 or $90 or even $10 goes a lot further than in North America, who can afford to work for a reduced rate. But be warned, their rates won't stay there for long. Snap them up while you still can. As soon as they get a couple of delighted testimonials under their belts, those rates will, deservedly, climb to a level where they can make a well-deserved living. Meanwhile, make the most of your bargain and promote your new product so you can afford their new rates next time you need them. When to post your job on Elance? You might want to start posting your job before you've even finished your product. You want to have enough time to pick and choose. Whatever you do, never, ever post a sales letter job at the last minute and expect people to work through weekends, evenings, holidays, or just even within a short time frame. You'll pay extra for any rush jobs. If you're reading this and you're realizing that hiring copywriter just won't work for you, or you haven't been able to find one within your budget, you may have no choice but to do it yourself, after all. In that case, find two or three sales letters that really make you want to buy, go back and look at ones from the last few products you purchased, and use them as your skeleton. Don't steal content, word for word, instead, look at what each section does. Go through your product and write bullet points based on the benefit, not the features, of each point. Write your bullet points first. What's the difference between a benefit and a feature? Oh, increase your income by 25% is a benefit. Oh, state-of-the-art, streamlined, platinum casing is a feature. Use well-researched long-tailed keywords in your headline and in your letter. You can create your all-important headline, the hook that grabs people's attention and makes them start to read your letter, either before you've written the sales body, or after. Again, once you start writing the actual sales copy, write straight through to the end. Go through the copy again, correcting mistakes, and tweaking only the essentials. Add in subheads, and emphasize particularly important bits of text. You want to add emphasis to points that will catch your reader's eye as he or she skims down the page. Most people will never actually read all your scintillating copy. They'll hit just enough data to convince themselves. Often all it takes is one bullet point. It will set up any autoresponder for me, guaranteed? Wow, with my little-known autoresponder service that I can't find any tutorials for, I really need that. And include a PS, reminding them of your product's biggest benefit. What about the design? Lots of white space, subheads, and bullet points, just like blog posts. Yes, graphics can help, but don't use graphics that distract. Your graphic designer is not a good source of feedback on this. Artists always think graphics are the be-all and end-all, but that's absolutely not true for sales letters. You can choose to use a header graphic for your sales letter, or not. There are lots of free, professionally designed header backgrounds you can download from places like PLR Canada. Just open the .psd file in Adobe Photoshop and insert your own information. Better yet, invest in professional custom design if you can possibly afford it. But a better idea is to reserve your graphic design budget for your actual bookie cover. And don't forget, you can always reduce your graphic to a small size as well, to insert into your sales letter. There are lots of free mini-site templates on the web, and if not, hire a mini-site designer. There are many inexpensive ones on the web, so you don't even need to post a job on Elance, most of the time. Why are they so inexpensive? They're most likely customizing an existing template. You will have chosen your product name back when you did your initial keyword research. It may change a little as you get started writing, or ask for feedback from a membership site or mastermind group. Once you've got the name solidified, however, it is time to commission your design. Hopefully, you can do this well ahead of your product launch deadline.